Hi, this is Manos Boulakis from the Minneapolis Heart Institute and the Cardiovascular Innovations Foundation, presenting video 30.1 for the Manual of Percutaneous Coronary Interventions. This video provides an overview of the equipment used for percutaneous coronary intervention. There are 14 steps for PCI, with equipment being necessary in all of those steps. And these are the 22 categories of equipment that will be discussed one by one in this video, starting with the sheaths that allow the catheters to get into the vessels and then reach the coronary arteries. The four key characteristics of a sheath is the diameter, with 6 French commonly used for diagnostic and 6 to 8 French for PCI. The length of the sheath, the thickness, with thin-walled sheaths being used more commonly for radial access, and finally the kink resistance, and this will be discussed in detail in video 30.2. Next are the catheters. These are essential for performing percutaneous coronary intervention. There are diagnostic catheters and guide catheters, with the diagnostic having thicker walls, and as a result, they have a smaller lumen compared with the guide catheters. There are various shapes, various diameters, varying between 4 to 6 French for diagnostic and 5 to 8 French for guide catheters. There are various lengths, with the standard being 100 centimeters, but there are shorter lengths for retrograde CTO PCI, for example, which are 90, as well as longer lengths such as 125 for very tall patients or those who have aortic tortuosity. Some guides have side holes and some have dimpled surface. For example, these are the Icari guides used via radial access. And this has been discussed in videos 5.3 and 5.4. The catheters have multiple roles. One is to engage the coronaries, to inject contrast. They can also be used to monitor the pressure and, of course, to deliver equipment to the coronary arteries. Moving on, number 3, guide extensions. An extremely useful tool, especially for complex PCI. There are various guide extensions that will be discussed in video 30.3. Those can help with vessel engagement as well as with delivering equipment down the coronary arteries. They can also be used for thrombectomy. They can be used for retrieval of entrapped equipment to facilitate the reverse CAR technique in retrograde CTO PCI, to minimize the risk of subintimal hematoma formation with undergrade dissection reentry, and actually they can also be used to form a snare, which again will be shown in a separate video. Category number 4 are support catheters. There are 4 of them, the Multicross, Centercross, Novacross, and Prodigy. These are mainly used for CTO PCI to increase support. For example, the Multicross has a 19-0 mesh that goes against the wall of the vessel, providing support for wire advancement. The center cross does the same thing, but does it for a microcatheter. There's also the Nova Cross and the Prodigy catheter that has a low pressure balloon. 5th category are the Y connectors, which there are the standard rotating hemostatic valves that are used infrequently those days, whereas there are those with an automated hemostatic valve, such as the Guardian, the Copilot, the OK2, and the Watchdog. And this is why using a non-rotating hemostatic valve is important to minimize blood loss that can often be substantial. This is an example of the OK2 that has a hemostatic valve, and as a result, it minimizes bleeding when there are catheter exchanges. Category number 6 are the microcatheters. There is also a separate video specific for this. Microcatheter means small catheters, from micros, which is small in Greek. There are 5 categories of microcatheters. The bigger or larger outside diameter microcatheters, such as the Corsair and the Turnpike, that are used mainly for undergrade CTO crossing. The smaller outside diameter microcatheters, such as the Turnpike LP, or the Corsair XS, or the Caravelle, or the Finecross, that are often used to advance through tortuosity. There are the angulated microcatheters that can be used to access side branches, for example, in bifurcation stenting. There are the dual lumen microcatheters that can be used for parallel wiring and also for accessing side branches. And then there are the plaque modification microcatheters that can be used to modify lesions. These are usually for balloon uncrossable lesions. There are multiple microcatheters that will be discussed in a separate video in each of those five categories, but it is important for every lab to have at least one microcatheter from each of the categories: big, small, angulated, dual lumen, and plaque modification. Category number 7, guide wires. These are also essential equipment for performing PCI. There are the 14,000s of an inch guide wires used in the coronary arteries, but also the thicker 0.035 inch guide wires that are used to advance catheters and the sheaths through the artery. The 0.014 inch guide wires, which are the wires used for PCI, these are the wires that are advanced into the coronary arteries and bypass grafts, can be classified into 7 categories, which is based on function. The first category are the workhorse wires, which are used in the majority of PCIs. These are soft wires, usually with a tip force of 1 gram or less, and that means that it takes 1 gram of force or less to bend the tip. These are very soft wires and therefore less traumatic and less likely to cause complications such as perforation. There are various subcategories such as the nitinol wires, the stainless steel wires, composite core and dual coil, and some of them also have a hydrophilic coating that facilitates delivery of the wire at the cost of potentially being more likely to cause complications such as dissection or perforation. The second major category are the polymer jacketed wires. These are wires that have a full thickness coating, so very slippery wires, and those can be subcategorized into the soft non-tapered, such as the Whisper, Pilot 50, Fielder FC, and Xeon Black, that are commonly used to advance through tortuosity or in the side branches, for example, during bifurcation PCI. There are also the soft tapered wires, like the Fielder XT, Fighter, and Bandit, which are the initial choice for undergrade CTO wiring for many operators. And then there are the stiff polymer jacketed wires, such as the Pilot 200, Gladius, Mongo, and Raider, which are used for more complex lesions, also often in CTO PCI. The third category of wires are those who have a stiff tip, which means their tip is a higher gram force requirement for bending. So these are more penetrating wires, which means they can go through more calcified proximal caps, but also they do have a higher risk of causing dissections or perforations. Some of those wires have intermediate stiffness in the 2 to 6 gram range, such as the Guy and the Judo, and some others, like the Confianza Pro 12, Hornet 14, Astato 20, have even higher tip stiffness, and those are often used for highly resistant proximal caps in CTO PCI. Category number 4 are the support wires. These are wires that have a very soft tip, but a very stiff and supportive body, and they're used for delivering equipment in complex PCI. Category number 5 are atherectomy wires. Atherectomy cannot be done over standard 0.014 wires. Instead, there are thinner wires, such as the Rotafloppy, which is 0.009, and the Viper, which is 0.012 inch, and these are the wires required for doing atherectomy. Category number 6 are the externalization wires. These are the RG3 and R350. These are specific for CTO PCI. These are long, 330 to 350 centimeter long wires that are thinner and are specifically designed for retrograde CTO PCI. And finally, category number 7, we have the pressure wires that can be used for coronary physiology. Moving on to the thicker wires, the 0.035 inch wires. There are the standard such wires that have a J-tip and a 3 millimeter radius that are used for advancing the sheath in or the catheters to the coronary ostium. There are also some of those wires that have a soft tip to advance through tortuosity or through diseased areas of the iliofemoral system, for example, the Benson wire, the Woolley wire, and the Stork wire. Then there are the polymer jacketed wires, which is a thicker version of the polymer jacketed wires used in the coronary. The classic example is the GlideWire. The GlideWire Advantage has a stiffer body, and there is the GlideWire Baby J that is specific for radial access and has a shorter 1.5 millimeter radius instead of 3 millimeter for the standard J-tip wires. And finally, similar to the coronary support wires, there are the peripheral support wires, such as the AmpLads, Super Stiff, the SupraCore, and the Landerquist. Those provide extra support, for example, for advancing sheaths through highly resistant femoral arteries that are diseased, or advancing high-profile equipment such as hemodynamic support devices. Moving on to category number 8, these are the embolic protection devices, indicated mainly for saphenous vein graft interventions, although they can be used also for cases with large thrombus burden. Two of them are available, the filter wire and the spider, and those will be discussed separately in separate videos, both for the filter wire as well as for the spider. Moving on to category number 9, the various balloons. These are key for lesion preparation and stent post-dilation. There are 7 categories of balloons. There are the standard balloons, but they can be either compliant or non-compliant. And then the specialty balloons that are very low profile balloon. Classic example is the Sapphire Pro for balloon and cross-up lesions. The plaque modification balloons. These are balloons such as the AngioSculpt, the cutting balloon, and the chocolate. Trapping balloons for exchanging equipment without losing wire position. The osteal flush balloon, which is specifically designed to flare the stents when placed in the osteal location. Drug-coated balloons, not available for coronary use in the US yet, but very useful, especially for small vessels and in stent restenosis. The very high pressure balloon, also not available in the US, that can go to 30-40 atmospheres for balloon and dilatable lesions. And finally, the intracoronary lithotripsy balloon, extremely useful for heavily calcified lesions, also not available for use in the coronaries yet in the United States. However, since the recent completion of Disrupt C83, it is likely to become available in 2021 in the United States. Category number 10 is atherectomy. There is orbital and rotational atherectomy, and this will be discussed in detail in separate videos. This is the Rotablator system, the Classic and the RotaPro, and also the orbital atherectomy, the Diamondback 360 system. Laser can also be extremely useful for balloon uncrossable and undilatable lesions. Also, it can be used for cases of thrombus. The machine is a little bulky and requires a 5-minute warm-up. And then when it's done into contrast, it creates some extra bubbles that can help with modifying the plaque, essentially like having micro explosions happening inside the coronary artery. Category number 12 are the thrombectomy catheters. Again, there will be a separate video, but we have mainly aspiration thrombectomy and the penumbra system. The aspiration thrombectomy can be done through a variety of catheters with different delivery profiles. There are 6 and 7 friends, with the 7 friends having a higher aspiration lumen and therefore being able to aspirate larger thrombi. And this is the penumbra system that is very similar but has also a pump, therefore is more consistent in terms of its suction capacity for thrombi. Category number 13 is equipment for treating osteal lesions. We discussed about the osteal flush balloon to flare the stents in the osteal location. There's also the Osteal Pro device that can be used to accurately position the stents when treating aorto-osteal lesions. Stents, there are bare metal stents, drug-eluting stents, and cover stents. There are 5 drug-eluting stents in the United States as of 2020. And a key characteristic of the stents is their post-dilation limit. Having this chart available is very important. When studying bifurcations, when there is significant size mismatch, Therefore, one wants to ensure that the stent plates can be post-dilated to the diameter that is desired in the proximal main vessel. Category number 5 are devices used for arterial closure. There are the angioseal and the perclose for femoral access, discussed in separate videos. There are also various other closure devices. And for the radial access, there are various radial bands that can be used to achieve hemostasis. This is the angioseal system. Essentially, there is the device with an anchor that goes inside the vessel and a collagen plug on the outside of the vessel. And then there is the perclose that delivers a suture around the arteriotomy site, achieving hemostasis. There's an example of the radial hemostasis devices. There are now specific devices for distal radial access, such as the Prelude Sync Distal. Category number 16 are equipment for CTO specifically and dissection reentry, and these are the CrossBoss and Stingray system. Intravascular imaging is very important for PCI and is covered separately and in 3 videos. But broadly, there are 2 modes of imaging, the optical coherence tomography and intravascular ultrasound. From IVUS, there are the rotational and the phased array systems, with the phased array systems having lower resolution, but doesn't require preparation. The rotational provide higher resolution, but do require preparation. Category 18 are complication management equipment, extremely important for percutaneous coronary intervention. And these are the cover stents, the coils, the vascular plugs, pericardiocentesis kit, and snares. 2 cover stents currently available in the United States, the PK Papyrus and the Graftmaster. PK Papyrus is more deliverable, and those will be covered in a separate video. Several coils are available. A broad categorization are the 0.014-inch coils, such as the Axiom, and the 0.018 coils, such as the Azure. The 0.014-inch coils are recommended because they can go through any standard microcatheter used for PCI, whereas the 0.018-inch coils do require a larger microcatheter or using the fine cross. The Amplatzer vascular plugs can be used to seal a site of perforation. They are more commonly used currently to occlude saphenous vein grafts or arteriovenous fistulae. And those are typically oversized by 30 to 50%. The AVP2 is the one most commonly used. Pericardiocentesis kit can be also useful in case of perforation and tamponade. That can expedite the procedure, but if it's not available, any standard 18-gauge needle can be used with a standard J-wire and a standard pigtail into the pericardium. Snares, very important equipment for retrieving lost equipment in the coronary and peripheral circulation. If there is no pre-made snare, such as the N-snare and the Amplatz-Kuznick snare, one can be made using a balloon and a wire through a guide catheter extension. There's a separate video for this. There are also some smaller snares that can be used inside the coronary artery, such as the Micro-Elite and the 2-4 millimeter mini N-snare. Number 19 is equipment for radiation protection. There are some disposable pads, such as the RAD pad, that can minimize scatter radiation to the operator, or systems like the zero gravity that protects the operator, taking the weight of the lead off the back of the operator. Category number 20 are hemodynamic support devices. For left ventricular support, we have 4 devices, the balloon pump, the Impella CP, Tandem Heart, and VA ECMO, and those devices will be discussed in separate videos. It's also very useful to have an external compression system in case of cardiac arrest in the cath lab that can facilitate ongoing compressions while attempts are being made to repair the coronary arteries. Category number 21 is contrast management. There are systems such as automated injectors and the diverse system that can minimize the amount of contrast administered to the patient and consequently the risk of contrast-induced acute kidney failure. And finally, there is the brachytherapy system. that is still used for recurrent in-stent restenosis. There's only one system, the beta radiation system, that can be used in both vein grafts and native coronary arteries. This was a long overview of the equipment. It is very important to keep the cath lab table organized. This is an example of a CTO intervention having the various guide wire used neatly organized so one can find the one that one wants without having to dig through a pile of equipment. Also, for complex PCI, it is nice to have a cart that contains the related equipment such as specialty wires, as well as microcatheters, various specialty balloons, as well as equipment for perforation such as coils and cover stents. But in the end, the most important equipment is the brain. The operator has to be able to understand which equipment might work best in every specific scenario, and this takes practice. So in summary, 22 equipment categories. This does take quite some time to master and use effectively, but effective use of equipment is critical to ensuring the success and the safety of the procedure. Thank you.